traditional country acts to retain their wide popularity during the 50s and 60s, when country music was undergoing major changes. Wilma Lee met Stoney during the mid-40s when she was singing with her sisters and parents in a West Virginia gospel group called the Leary Family Singers. Stoney was hired by the group as a fiddler and soon married Wilma Lee. By 1947, Wilma Lee and Stoney were making records and were regulars on the WWVA Jamboree in Wheeling, West Virginia. They and their band, the Clinch Mountain Clan, sang mainly traditional mountain songs and gospel standards. They joined the Grand Ole Opry in 1954 and soon after recorded a Don Gibson composition entitled There's a Big Wheel, which became a huge hit in 1959. Stoney Cooper was known throughout musical circles as a collector and performer of the true Scotch-Irish mountain music, and after his death in 1977, Wilma Lee has carried on that tradition. She continues to be a favorite performer along with the Clinch Mountain Clan at bluegrass festivals throughout the United States. And let's look at Wilma Lee and Stoney Cooper on a performance that was filmed nearly 20 years ago. That was Wilma Lee and Stoney Cooper back in 1965. And we got a gal here that can tell us more about that 30-year career that they did together than anybody I can think of. It's our guest for today, Wilma Lee herself.
Hi, Archie. Wilma Lee. Hi, it's nice to be here with you.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Thank you. Yes.
We were going to talk about people we've known over a period of years you've worked with, and how you got started. And so how did you get started?
Well, I got started with my family, the Leary family, up in West Virginia, as our home state. And then we worked down in Virginia, out of Harrisonburg, Virginia, WSVA. My family were gospel singers, Archie, and that's mother and dad and the three girls.
Yeah.
And I had two sisters. And then we sung the country songs, my two sisters and I.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, it wasn't totally gospel then.
No, the family was gospel,
oh,
but
I
not
see.
The girls. Right.
Well, did you work separately?
No, well, just in the programs all.
Yeah. Yeah, within the gospel program,
mm-hmm.
you did some
right.
country stuff too.
That's right.
What is this story about Eleanor Roosevelt organizing something, and she had you folks?
Mm-hmm. She organized the first National Folk Festival.
Oh, really?
That was in 1938.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a group from each state representing that state in Washington, D.C. for a week for that folk festival. And there was contests in each state. And I know in our state, my family won the one in this region where we lived. But then they, at the end, they took all the regional winners and put them in one big contest, and my family won. So we went to Washington, D.C., representing our home state of West Virginia. Went in 38 and 39, mm-hmm. 2 years.
How did you meet Stoney?
My family went into radio after we had went to Washington, D.C. They went started in radio in Harrisonburg, Virginia. And Stoney, we heard him on Fairmont, West Virginia. He played fiddle for a group there called the Green Valley Boys, uh-huh. Rusty Heiser and the Green Valley Boys. Now, we never met him, but we heard him, and then we knew he was from Harmon, West Virginia. Harmon is like 30 miles from Elkins, West Virginia, going down towards the Virginia state line. You go right on into Elkins, Harmon, Franklin, uh-huh. and then Harrison.
Right. And then he joined the Leary and family?
Yes.
How long was it before you got married?
He came to work for my family in early 38. And yes, because Uncle Andy went with us there in 38. And then he stayed with the family, well, till after we were married. We got married in 41, and June the 9th of 1941. And then after Carol was born, we were working in Wheeling, West Virginia, the family was then. And so Stoney and I decided the family was getting ready to move on, because that's the way you did back in those days. Mm-hmm. You'd work at a radio station so long, go to another and work.
That's because you played the territory out.
That's right.
And once you'd been there four or five times, you've got to move on to...
to a new territory.
...where you haven't been.
That's right. So over the years, we were all over the country like that. And then we ended up back up in later years at Wheeling, where we stayed 10 years. But anyway, Stoney thought, well, we just couldn't raise Carol and be on the road, you know, like you worked every night out on the road, and uh-huh. you'd come in, make the radio program, and go again. So that lasted about 6 months. He got a job driving a soft drink truck, Vaughn Beverage Company, mm-hmm. out of Wheeling. And so he delivered the soft drinks down the river and to the stores and all the places where they buy the soft drinks. And he'd leave way before daylight of a morning, and he wouldn't get back till midnight at nights.
Oh, golly, he had about a 12-hour day.
Yes, yeah, oh, a good 12-hour. Yeah. And so you can see why he decided maybe we could do it in country music.
I bet you during that time, Carol, hurry up and grow up.
Yes, well, she was just little, and so then we went from there to Grand Island, Nebraska.
Where?
Grand Island, Nebraska.
Oh, Nebraska.
Yes.
Boy, that was a big change, wasn't it?
A big jump, too.
Were you the Clinch Mountain Clan at that time?
No, it was just Stoney and I then.
And what was your name then?
Just Wilmley and Stoney Cooper.
Wilmley and Stoney Cooper.
Uh-huh. And we didn't form the Clinch Mountain Clan till we came from there into WIBC Indianapolis, and from there to WJJD Chicago.
Yeah.
And worked there till they went on strike. The union had them to go on strike, trying to force the Atlas Brothers to hire more people. And they couldn't afford to hire more people because the scale was so high.
Yeah.
And then they decided the best thing to do was not use country music, just go with the live music, go with the records. So that's when we went into Fairmont, West Virginia, and built our first band. And have carried a band ever since.
And that was
in 45.
Gang?
No, he called that the Blues Chasers then.
Oh, I see.
Because we used for a theme song, Sun's Gonna Shine in Your Back Door Someday,
yeah.
and the Carter Family song, and the last line, We're Here to Drive Your Blues All Away. So then he said, got to thinking, that wasn't a good name, really, Blues Chasers. So he said, now we're from these mountains, down there out of Pendleton County, where the Clinch Mountain chain run on up, right on up through, you know, they owned one of those mountaintops there.
Is that still the Appalachian chain?
Yes, uh-huh. We decided, since that was where he was from, and I was from up there 30 miles further, we just called it by the mountains we was out of, and that's why
Clinch Mountain?
Uh-huh, Clinch Mountains.
Did you and Stoney write a lot of your own material?
Yes, I used to write an awful lot. And then...
You've written some pretty good records.
Yes, I've had some. And then I just all at once, I quit writing. I've never written anything in a long time.
Yeah. Well, did you?
Got too busy, really.
Well, yeah.
You just have too many things to do.
Would you write folk ballads? Mountain-type things? Or?
No, it really wasn't mountain. It was just really old, true, hard country that I wrote.
The way
we were raised there in those mountains.
Now, your group has been called the most authentic example of American folk music. You're in the Library of Congress, the Harvard Library of Music, even in the Smithsonian.
Yes.
Now, how did they find you?
The Smithsonian in 73 called and they wanted to do a series called Women in Country Music. And they used me for the first woman in that series. And wanted me to be sure and bring the banjo, too, to pick the banjo on that. So we did a two-hour show there at the Baird Auditorium for the Smithsonian.
A lot of people don't know that the only true American instrument is the banjo.
Five-string banjo.
Every other instrument we know of came from some other country.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
We'll be right back with Wilma Lee Cooper in just a moment. Last performance of Wilma Lee and Stoney Cooper. What a song. It was a biggie.
Yes, it was.
Fast, good beat to it.
Oh, yes. Don Gibson wrote that.
Yeah. Now, when did you join the Opry?
January 12th of 1957.
You got that date right, didn't you?
Yes, don't forget
that. Had you always wanted to do that?
Yes, that's what we had worked for. You know, that's in the days when we were working these different radio stations, the Grand Ole Opry was the show, you know.
And it covered all the stations you had to move to and from.
Right, and you could hear it anywhere you were.
Right.
So that was what all entertainers worked for. It was the Grand Ole Opry. So we worked, and finally we got an audition at the Grand Ole Opry, and they told us that they would call us and give us our starting date. And now this is back before we ever came here. And we're still in Wheeling at this time. And they said to go ahead and sell that record shop. We had a store up there, sell that store and just get everything in order. And on Monday they'd call us. That was on a Wednesday. Well, Monday came and they never called. And Tuesday and they never called. So Stoney said, well, maybe I'd better call them Wednesday. Well, something had happened. The deal was clear off.
Oh.
So, yeah, clear off. Stoney said, well, we don't have to move. We were the top act. We was paying the top money to the booking office at WWVA and had for ever since we started working there. They always posted it each week. You paid 5% of all your show dates to advertise them for you.
Yeah, at Wheeling.
At Wheeling. So he said, well, we don't have to move. And so he said, we'll just concentrate here. And so then we started buying things there, you know, just really digging in to make that home. And we worked a show in Richmond, Virginia, at the mosque over there. And Johnny Cash was on the show, and Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs, Marty Robbins. And I really don't know who all. It was a big show. But anyway, they had hired us out of Wheeling for that advertising off of WWTA.
Right.
We opened the show.
It's where the promoters used to work.
That's right. So we were the openers of the show. We opened that show. And D. Kilpatrick was the Opry manager then, and he was up there with the folks from the Grand Ole Opry. And after he watched our first show, that matinee, he come and talked with Stoney and told him he'd like to have us at the Opry. Yes.
What were some of your biggest hits?
Well, the Big Midnight Special.
Yeah.
There's a Big Wheel, Come Walk With Me, Walking My Lord of Calvary's Hill, The Legend of the Dogwood Tree, a lot of gospel we've had.
Yeah.
Tramp on the Street, This World Can't Stand Long.
Did you write all those?
Most of those.
Yeah.
I didn't write Tramp on the Street, and I didn't write This World Can't Stand Long.
Yeah.
But there's a Big Wheel. I wrote half of Come Walk With Me. Big Wheel was written by Don Gibson. I wrote the Big Midnight Special. Then we had Cheetah
Too. You had a lot of records on that, didn't you?
Yeah.
Who all did that?
Oh, I just don't know. I think they
almost
said there was
everybody.
40-some, yes. Cheetah 2, that was the record we had going when we came to the Opry.
Yeah. We'll be right back with Wilma Lee Cooper in just a moment.
Well, let's see, we won an award for Come Walk With Me, Midnight Special, There's a Big Wheel, and let me see.
The Midnight Special you wrote.
Yes.
Big Midnight Special, shine your light on me. Big Midnight Special, shine your level of a light on me. Woke up this morning, heard the whistle blow. The jailer said, come boy, it's time to go. Big Midnight Special, shine your light on me. Big Midnight Special, shine your level of a light on me.
That was Wilma Lee and Stoney Cooper with one of their favorites. You went through a period, though, that was a real shocker when Stoney passed away.
Yes,
that wasn't too long ago.
No, it hasn't been, about 6 years ago now. Stoney got sick. He'd had a heart attack in 63.
Mm-hmm.
And but he was he'd done well after that heart attack. But then in later years, it just seemed like his health was... He just got run down, like to where if the cold went around, he had the cold. If the flu went around, he got the flu. Whatever was going around, he'd get.
Mm-hmm.
So in later years, the last about 3 years of his life, he just didn't have good health at all. And he just seemed to be getting weaker. And on Friday, I was taking him back to the doctor. We had appointments like every day. And got ready to get him out, and he didn't answer me. And he was sitting there dead, and the doctor come running and gave him the shot in the heart.
Was this in the car?
Uh-huh, at the doctor's office. And
he went away quick then, didn't he?
Well, no, the doctor got a heartbeat back. They took me in the office, rushed the car to the hospital right around the corner. And in about 5 minutes, they got a heartbeat. And he lived 46 days in intensive care, but he never woke up. To where he could ever talk to you or anything. In 46 days.
You can be an example to a lot of people right now who have never gone through that, and you did.
Yes.
And that was one of the hardest things in the world to do. What do you think was your greatest contribution or accomplishment?
It's hard to say. I think one of the greatest accomplishments...
How would you like to think was the greatest?
...was getting to come to the Grand Ole Opry. There's been a lot of nice things happened to Stoney and I over the years, but I like to think that that we did nothing to harm our music, that us being here maybe has added a little to it. Whenever we're gone, Stoney's already gone when I'm gone, but maybe we'll be remembered for the little bit that we have given back to it. It's been good to us over our years, and I sure have tried to be good to it.
Well, you want me to tell you something? You have been good to it.
Well, certainly hope so.
You're beautiful.
Oh, thank you, Archie.
You're a beautiful lady. And you got a beautiful daughter.
Oh, yes, I'm proud of her.
And your husband was a handsome man.
Yeah, he was pretty good looking, wasn't he?
He was. And you're a charming guest. I've enjoyed talking
to
you.
Well, thank you. I sure thank you for asking me to be out here and visit with you and all your nice listeners.
Thank you. We've been talking with Wilma Lee Cooper. Join us again for Yesteryear in Nashville.